Good evening, everybody, and welcome to this event, this gathering, as we are here together to bask in God's glory and in the Holy Spirit's presence before our Lord and Savior. Let us join together in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity for us to be together, to cherish you and to worship you as your children and as your co-heirs. Lord, we pray for your presence in this place. We pray for unity. And we pray for your blessings to overflow over us and over this evening. In your perfect name, we pray all these things. Amen.
Amen.
Born is the King.
Because God calls us sons and daughters. So let us all join together as we sing, We Three Kings.
Thank you.
Bless ye, merry gentlemen.
Let nothing you dismay.
Remember Christ our Savior
was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power. And when we're gone astray, all tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy.
Sometimes I think about our roles here as people and the ones who occupy this earth, and I like to think of us as the ones God entrusted to now be the herald angels harking his gospel and his truth and his love to others. So I like to remember that as we sing, Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
Born to raise the
the introducing person, because there's a lot of speakers and a lot of people that are going to be up on the stage. So we have somebody who's going to let you know exactly what's going on. At the Minnetonka Church. This is the Young Adults and Minnesota Conference Public Campus Ministry. And I welcome you as one of the young adult leaders here at Minnetonka Church. And here, I'm going to pass it to my husband.
Hey everyone, my name's Paul. I'm the young adult elder here at Minnetonka, and we're so happy and excited you guys are all here. We're really excited to hear a really great testimony tonight. So I hope you guys all stick around. I'm going to pass it over to Colin now. I think he has some more announcements. So thank you.
Hey, so my name is Colin King. I'm the assistant to the PCM director. First of all, I want to welcome you all here. It's so nice to see you guys here. This is actually our fourth PCM event, so welcome. So we're gonna have a Christmas concert, but before we get started with that and we continue with things, I just wanna give you a couple announcements. Next month, the third week in January, I believe it's January 15th, we are having another PCM event, but it's going to be at the Edge. So if you like the music here, our praise team that has been doing the song selection is actually from the Edge, and so we're going to take it at the Edge, and we're going to have Monique speak for us there. And then, Monique is going to be our speaker there. We also have a PCM retreat that's happening in March. So during the third week in March, we'll be up at North Star Camp doing our PCM retreat. And that's all the announcements I have so far. So let's bow our heads and get ready for prayer. We'll get right into that concert. Heavenly Father, thank you for having us here. And I thank you for allowing us to have our fourth PCM event. I pray that you be with our performers, and I pray that you bless them and inspire them, Lord. I pray that our mission can continue to reach the young adults in Twin Cities. And in Jesus' name, amen. So our first performance is going to be done by Aaron Cisse on the euphonium. He'll be playing O Holy Night. Thank you.
I have some new accessories. Thanks to my sister. In the chill of the night, while the moon gently sleeps, I wander in silence on snow-laden streets. As I gaze into sunsets over silhouette mountains, I am amazed that the God who made all this were open, I began to believe the mystery of Christmas was truly real. A great host of angels came calling to me, back to the pure sacred peace. Singing la 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 la, is a Savior born to us today. Singing la 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 la, the Messiah. Certain I'm never alone. Now let all of your children feel the love that you gave, and in honor of you, give it away. Sing it. Away in a manger, no crib for a bed, the little Lord Jesus laid down his sweet head. The stars in the bright sky looked down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay. The cattle are lowing, the baby awakes, but little Lord Jesus no crying he makes. I love thee, Lord Jesus, look down from the sky and stay by my cradle till morning is nigh. Be near me, Lord
Jesus, I ask thee to stay close by me forever, and love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in thy tender care, and take us to heaven to live with thee
there. All right, so I'm going to introduce a speaker. Our speaker who will be speaking for our event is Denzil McNeilus. So open up your hearts and mind to his devotional thoughts.
Thank you. Well, it's certainly a privilege and honor to be with you this evening on this special weekend, the weekend before Christmas. And before I start, I'd like to pray if we could. Our Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for the privilege of being able to meet together. Lord, I pray that the words be spoken be your words. But most of all, Lord, I pray that all honor, glory, and praise will go to you and you alone. For we ask in thy name, amen. Well, my favorite text in the Bible is Matthew 24:14. Where it says, this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all nations, and then the end will come. So I got a question I'd like to ask you. How many here want to go to heaven? Can I see your hands? Okay. Can I ask you a second question then? What are you doing about it? If you think about it, if you look at prophecy and you look at the Bible, everything's happened in the world that needs to happen except for telling everyone about Jesus. Once that's completed, we can go home, right? So I was blessed. I grew up in a Seventh-day Adventist home. I met my wife in the eighth grade. We went to academy. I went to college. And I decided to take business because I wanted to be in the family business that my father started, which is building concrete mixers. And when I got out of school, I wanted to be the first Adventist billionaire. Amen. That was my goal. Because I believe that my job should be to make money, give it to the professionals, give it to the people that can help the Lord's work. And that's what I was supposed to do. And I was supposed to be in business. And I really believe that's what my job was. I mean, I was obsessed with the goal of being profitable, making it, getting a business growing and going about my work as being in a business. And, I was a typical, I would hate to say not typical, hopefully, Adventist. I always go to my Sabbath afternoon lay activities, which was taking a nap, you know. And then I would just go on to my work all during the week. You know, I believe that when you're working hard and, you know, when you're in business, it's like being in they're talking a lot about the Olympics right now, you know. And, to be a successful in business is like being an Olympic athlete. You have to do a lot of work, training, you got to study, you got to do a lot of things to be in business. And I always believed you need to work half days. That's 12 hours a day. And then beyond that, do all the other things that you need to do to be successful in business. And of course, we want the Lord's blessing. And I think that's the most important thing. And one thing, if I could leave with you today, I want to suggest that the most important thing is whatever you do in life, make God your partner and ask him to be your partner in whatever you do. Because if you have him as your partner, everything else just falls by the way. Everything else becomes very easy. Now, don't get me wrong. You still have to work. You still have to do your other parts of it. But I believe that's very important that if you make the Lord your partner, a lot of the stress that we normally worry about in a lot of businesses today, you don't need to worry about because God's your partner. So Like I mentioned, I wanted to be an Adventist billionaire. I was working. We were doing one thing we started doing after we started building concrete mixers. We decided that instead of paying tithe at the end of our year, because, you know, you have good months and bad months, we decided to tithe and give offerings to every time we tied it to our concrete mixers. So every time we sold the mixer, we put so much to tithe, so much to offering. Guess what? The Lord blessed. And so it blessed so much that we doubled it. And then it blessed so much that we doubled it again. And before we sold our business, and we were launching a new product every 4 to 6 weeks, we would pray how much the Lord should we put to tithes and offerings in our product before we sold it and before we took it to market. Well, I wanted, because I was in business and I wanted to make money, and I didn't want to spend a lot of time, because the professionals, the church leaders, were supposed to do their work, and the pastors, and I was supposed to do my work. I never took any appointments. I didn't see anybody that I didn't need to see because I was busy working. And all of a sudden, this gentleman came to my office and said, "Denzel, I want you to join this organization called ASI." And I let him in because my wife and I knew him from, because he was actually a he actually did a week of prayer at our school. And so he came into my office. He said, "You want to join this organization, ASI?" And he told me about it a little bit. I was busy and I really was half listening. And I'm trying to think, how do I get him out of my office, right? And he says, so all of a sudden I look at him, I go, "How much does it cost to join?" And he told me how much it costs to join. And I thought, this is a cheap way of getting him out of my office. Okay, I'll join. So I joined the organization, and then he said, "Well, you got to fill out this paperwork." And I said, "I don't have time to fill out paperwork. If you want me to join, you have to fill out the paperwork." I was a little rude. And so he sat at my, because I had a conference table in my office, and he sat down, filled out all the paperwork. I went over to my assistant and said, "Hey, get him a check real quick. Give him the money." So he filled out the paperwork. I signed it real quickly. Of course, while he's filling out the paperwork, I'm working. And I give him, I have the check ready. So when he gets done, I hand him the check. And as I'm walking, you ever go and you walk someone, you lead them out of your place with your hand, you know? Well, I'm leading him out of the place of hand. He says, "You got to promise me you'll come to an ASI convention." But the man would not let go of my hand. And I said, "Okay, I'll come." And so he walks off the way, and I go home, and I tell my wife about this gentleman who came to my office, and I told her about this organization, ASI, and she goes, "Well, you're going to have to go to the convention." And I looked at her, and I says, "I have no intention of going to an ASI convention." And she said, "Well, you gave your word." And I said, "Well, that wasn't my real word. That was my get him out of my office promise. That wasn't a real promise." Well, you know, I don't know if you, those of you that are married, most of you good people are young people, but you'll learn this as you go through life, is when you compromise with your wife, you do what your wife wants to do. And so we argued back and forth. And 2 days before the convention, we decided, bought tickets, and went to the convention. Well, I'm a little bit more bold now than I was back then, but I was very shy. I didn't like talking to people I didn't know and this type of thing. Well, the convention was clear out in the middle of basically nowhere. And so we drove out to this convention, and all of a sudden I realized I got to eat with people that I don't know. I got to go to meetings I'm not really sure I want to go to. And, you know, I'm used to not doing this type of thing. And then all of a sudden I'm in this group of people at this convention in the nowhere in New Mexico. And I walk into this convention and I sit down in the meetings and I start listening to these people. And these people have businesses that were a lot larger than ours, but they weren't just giving their money. They were going on mission trips. They were giving Bible studies. They were doing Revelation seminars. They were helping in evangelistic meetings. And I looked at it and I says, you know, if those people can do it, I can do it too. And then I sit down at tables to eat, which is something I normally would not do, but there was nowhere place to eat. The closest another restaurant was over 45 minutes away. And so I sat down to eat with people I didn't know at a table. And, you know, I was used to going to like concrete and garbage truck conventions where people talk about their new house, their new car, their new boat, their new wife, or whatever it was. And you know, that's what they talked about. When I went to ASI, I sat around these tables, and they said, They talked about their mission trip. They talked about sharing Jesus in their marketplace. They talked about giving Bible studies. And you know what? I had nothing to tell them because I wasn't doing any of those things. And at this time, you know, we were helping with different projects. And so I was feeling, well, maybe I need to get more involved and I need to get more involved in the church. And, you know, these people are doing it. Maybe I'm missing something that in my life that I should be doing. And these people who had helped on mission trips says, would you like to go on a mission trip? Because that was one of the things that the people were doing. And I go, well, I haven't been on a mission trip before, but sure, I'll go on a mission trip. This is something I could do to get started, right? So I go on this first mission trip. Now, you got to realize that my idea of roughing it is a Holiday Inn. My idea of bad service is waiting an extra 15 minutes at a restaurant. Okay? So all of a sudden, we go down to Venezuela and Colombia. And go down to Venezuela, and I get there, and the first thing that happens is my luggage gets stolen. Okay? Now, try to find clothes my size in South America. Okay, you know, they go grande. I go grande shoe, you know, and they bring out their grande shoe. It's a size 10, and I wear a size 14. Okay, and you get pants, and I get them on. They come down to about your ankle. And so anyway, they steal my lawn. And the Lord has his timing because they steal my luggage. I get to this place where I didn't know. Our plane got delayed, and we get into the truck, and there's about this much play in the steering wheel. And I looked over at the guy and I says, are you going to get your steering fixed? And he goes, yeah, it is fixed. You should have been here yesterday. And he starts taking me up this windy mountain road that I, you know, of course, you got to realize I'm in Minnesota where it's flatlands, you know. And we go up this windy road and there's all these crosses along the road. And I didn't know what those were for. And there was washout roads and everything else. And we get up to the top of the mountain to this village and I get into the hotel. And I go by this guy with machine gun, and he smells so bad like marijuana, I was afraid I was going to get high just walking by him. And he was a security guard. We walk into the hotel, and I will tell you what, that hotel was something I'd never stayed at in my life. You had a spout, and you could use it to fill the toilet. You could have a bucket to wash yourself with, or it goes over the sink. One spout like that. You got one blanket and one sheet, and you could use it any way you wanted to. And I was miserable. And I'm thinking, here these people are trying to impress me because I'm going to a mission trip, right? I'm going to go see a facility that we've helped finance. And they're putting me in a place like this. I was so discouraged. I wanted to go home. I was thinking, you know, I just want to go home. I don't want to be here. And then, of course, you know how the roosters and the chickens fighting. The roosters are crowing in the middle of the night and the dogs are fighting below my window. And I'm just miserable. And you know what? They charged me $17 for that room, and I thought it was the most overpriced room I've ever stayed at in my whole life. And I get up to the top of the mountain where this ministry was, and I get up to the top of the mountain, and I go up there, and I realize that where I stayed was nice compared to where they stayed. I go sit in a church that has three sides. And one side has a tarp on it. The benches are so rough you don't want to wiggle. Okay? But I start hearing these stories. I meet this guy. I call him Little Giant. He stood about that tall. He was a bread baker. That's how he made his living. But he was given 50 Bible studies himself. I met this couple that were walking 8 hours through the jungle to get Bible studies in a village. Crossing rivers and everything in streams. And I'm sitting here hearing all these stories. And my cousin Pat, he owns McNeilus Steel. We were together and he's pretty quiet. And I'm sitting on the bench and I'm just saying, Pat, I just can't believe it. Here's people doing all these things for missions. And I'll never forget, he doesn't say anything. He just hands me a quotation. And it was an Ellen White quote from Gospel Workers, page 351 and 352. And the quote says, the work on this earth can never be finished until the men and women comprising of our church membership rally to the work and unite their efforts with church leaders and ministers. And all of a sudden, that just hit me. I'm sitting there in this rough bench. I'm listening to these people that are doing so much. And I thought to myself, look at these people here. They're doing so much for Jesus, and they have so little. I have so much, but I'm doing so little. And I realized that it really hit me right then and there. God doesn't need our money, does he? Because it's all his anyway, right? What he wants is us. And I realized there and then, sitting in that bench in the middle of a mountain, that God wants us to be missionaries for him. Now, each one of us has a privilege of being able to witness wherever we are. Now, it doesn't matter if you're in school or you're in your business or in your profession or whatever part of the world you're in, the Lord has given you an opportunity to witness right where you are. And I believe more than ever that right now in this world's history, that's what we need to spend our time on, is focus on witnessing right now where we are. Now, I can tell you all the things that have happened to me through the years, and there's been a lot. I've been blessed, and I'm an old man, so I can tell a lot of stories. We built our business up. We sold it. I got involved in evangelism, got involved in this organization of ASI. I've been a member since. By the way, I want to tell you, when I went to that first convention, my wife and I have not missed one convention since that day. And my best friends are ASI members because they are the people that we do mission trips with. They're the people we plan evangelism with. They're the people that I get encouragement. As a matter of fact, I probably text and talk to about three or four of them today. And the point that I think is so important and how we've been blessed through the years, and I know time is very short, but, you know, by making the Lord your partner and by being involved in evangelism, it's the greatest joy in the world. You know, I mentioned that I wanted to be the first Adventist billionaire. Remember I've mentioned that? Well, I will tell you, I found something worth way more than $1 billion. And that's the price of a soul. And that's what we can contribute. That's what we can each do, is become billionaires in our own right by reaching other people for Jesus. And I believe now more than ever, with what's going on in our world today, what's going on with, unfortunately, there's people that we have. I see some people in the audience who's probably more than not as many as we should or whatever, with masks on because of the COVID crisis, because of what's going on in our world. But people are afraid. There's opportunities to witness like never before. And if you pray, a good friend of mine always said that, Denzel, if you pray for a divine appointment, the Lord will give them to you. And I firmly believe it. I'm in, we're in the mixer business. The Lord bless us. We were able to grow to the largest mixer manufacturer in the world. We sold that business. I didn't know what I wanted to do. I thought I wanted to retire. That lasted less than 2 weeks. My wife looked at me and said, this isn't your office and I'm not your secretary. Go get an office and go get a secretary. And I bought a little bank as an investment, and actually we've been able to bless and grow that bank into something here in the Minneapolis and southern part of the Minnesota. And it's amazing, almost on a daily basis, I have an opportunity to witness. What I did is in my office, I took everything out that I couldn't use as a witnessing opportunity, so that we can utilize that to, when people come into your office, you can witness for them, for Jesus. And I firmly believe that each one of us has an opportunity to reach people that no one else can reach. Now, I'm a banker. That's how I make my living. But my real job is to tell others about Jesus. And that's what each one of us has a privilege, an honor, and an obligation to do, is to tell others about Jesus and his soon return. Thank you.
I could.
If I may just share with you how I got to learn the McNeilus name. I mean, I'm one of those people who easily forget people's names. So I'm sure you already noticed. So I forget very well. But I was in Bangladesh once, and I went to the school campus. And the name of the school was quite unique, McNeilus School, Adventist School. So I'm thinking, McNeilus, why out of all names in Bangladesh that they would choose McNeilus? Now, this is when I was working at the General Conference. And later on, when I was coming to Minnesota Conference, a friend of mine introduced to this one gentleman. And the reason why he wanted to meet with me is because he has an interest that he's been doing Bible study with and is trying to introduce him to reconnect with Adventist Church. And so I found myself not knowing who this gentleman is. And I sat, and this humble man came. He was calling me Pastor Moon. He was so respectful. So I had to reciprocate by saying, Elder, you know. And then that was how we first met at a restaurant. And some of you know who this gentleman is. His name is Malcolm, the one who played organ for us. When the conference asked me to provide leadership for young adult and public campus ministries, I was presented with the reality that we have so many wonderful universities here in Minnesota, including U of M, which you are a freshman, and Alex, which you are a freshman as well. But we don't have any active campus ministry here in Minnesota. And you know what, my prayer is, what if every year we'll have 12 of our young people who are committed with missionary spirit, who would volunteer and say, next year I'm going to become campus ambassador. I'm not asking you to stop schooling, but what I'm saying is, what if you commit 1 hour per day and give that time to the Lord? So Elder McNeilus, Brother Denzel, actually the reason why we gather here tonight is because we're going to have a special prayer for public campus ministry launching in U of M. We don't have anything. We don't know who are there, but what we know is we have so far identified 4 Seventh-day Adventist freshmen and 1 graduate. And I'm going to ask right now Alex Raforzo to please come. He's the public campus ministry director of Minnetonka Church, and Aaron, who is a freshman. And is there anyone who is from University of Minnesota, U of M? Okay, all right. And what we're going to do is, I'm going to ask you, I know we have a musical program, but I want Elder Denzel to bless these 2 young people. I'm gonna lay my hand, we're gonna lay our hands on them. And you know what, I'm praying that one day, Alex, he could be a billionaire, first Advent billionaire, or Aaron, but that we will see another godly people.
Amen.
Would inspire many other people like you are, and whose life mission is not the mammon, but to serve the Lord.
Amen.
So this is why we're here. I believe we pray together, Colin. I would like to also ask the Again 1888 team. This is the young adult leadership team of the conference, who are committed in having this monthly gathering. And we talked about it, Elder McNeilus, that what if in a couple of years, we can have a mission congress, something like GYC, but this is Mission Minneapolis, where once general conference session took place. So that's the reason why our motto is again 1888, where Minneapolis become the center of missionary sending, you know. So at this time, I'm going to ask the leadership of the again 1888, and you know who you are, Emily, join us, Monique, and we have John at the back, and we're going to all just stand behind them, kind of committing ourselves. Maybe you can put your hands on either my shoulder or either Denzel's shoulder, and we're going to lay our hands on them. And I'm going to ask Gladys, thank you. I almost forgot, Gladys and Emily. And after you pray, I'm going to continue that prayer. And what we're doing is we're consecrating these PCM ambassadors, and we want to see our PCM chapter in Yovan. I think we can do that, right? So please.
Our Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for the privilege of being able to be here and to be able to consecrate these young men and women to your work. And Lord, especially I pray for these two gentlemen as they start their team, as they start to work for you in the university. Lord, I pray that you'll give them guidance, that you'll guide and direct in all that they do, that you'll give them holy boldness to be able to be ambassadors and witness for you, that they may draw people to you, and that they will be able to have divine appointments to worship, to meet people, and to share you and your love to the campus of the University of Minnesota. Lord, I pray that you'll guide and direct them, give them courage and strength to follow your will and to do the work that you want them to do. Bless them, Lord, we ask in thy name. Amen.
Amen. Loving Heavenly Father, Lord, this is a very special place. The Adventist roots are from here, Minneapolis, in Minnesota. Lord, we pray that you will revive the missionary generation, starting from us, so that people will know that some of the most committed and selfless missionary come from Minnesota, Lord. Thank you for our missionaries, like Elder Denzel, and many others, as we rally together, as we support one another, as we pray and motivate one another. May this conference be known as the conference where some of the most dedicated missionaries would come. Lord, I pray that you will be with Alex and Aaron. It's not going to be easy to start something from the scratch. But Lord, we believe we can do it. And I also pray for those who are standing behind me. These are the people who have committed that we want to start missionary movement here in Minnesota. May you consecrate it, and may you, you know, use them mightily for your honor and glory. Lord, as we continue singing tonight, may you be praised and may you be glorified. Lord, thank you for being the first missionary and also charging us to follow you. We want to follow you. We want to be your missionaries. This is our prayer in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen. All right, enjoy your God, your peace. Oh, thank you. It's a real blessing.
Good evening, everyone. We're going to move on to our offertory. Today's offering is going to be going to public campus ministries for Minnesota. But before we collect the offering, I just want to say a few words. I want to thank...
This offering is going to be used to start a campus ministry at U of M.
Start a campus, public campus ministry in U of M, yes. I want to thank Pastor Moon and Pastor Mark for being there for young adults like me, for mentoring us, even though sometimes it's hard for us to communicate, being busy with college and everything, they never gave up on us. And if you could find it in your heart to give even just a little bit, to keep ministries like this going for students like me, that would be very much appreciated. Thank you.
I find it fitting that we're singing "Oh, Colin" because I actually heard on the radio the other day that this song was written not as a hymn to be sung in church, but as a rallying call to any and all people to come into God's grace and come into God's mercy. So I was looking forward into the direction of mission work and ministry, that we continue on the heart of the song to call out to all and bring them into God's loving arms.
we also call to our brothers and sisters, we also call on the name of Emmanuel, and to not only have hope in his presence, but have trust that when he calls, when we call him, he will come.
Babe inside, and I wonder what I
the Lord I pray in a world as cold as snow. Must I walk this path alone? Be with me now. Be
inspirational. I mean, if I'm not really into, you know, invading somebody's privacy, but I would love to read her diary. You know, I'd love to get inside of her mind, be a close person to her to know exactly how she was feeling, because that is quite the burden to bear. And I kind of like to think that that burden or that task is passed on to all of us, because the same way that she had Christ inside of her, we all have Christ inside of us, and we are meant to bring him now into this world and continue on in the mission of spreading his love.
Thank you.
Sing the grand finale, doxology.
Praise God from whom blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures. others here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
So our program is about to close. I'm going to invite Pastor Moon to come forward. He's going to close us out in prayer.
I'd like to ask Colin to close with prayer, however. but I want to say thank you to everyone, especially young people from Pathway Church. We appreciate you guys. You guys did a great job, so thank you so much. So let's give God praise. And once again, we have refreshments for you. You know that this is what we do when we invite you. We make sure that you don't go back home hungry. So they're all ready for you. So let's have a wonderful fellowship. And once again, thank you for coming. As we mentioned, now the Young Adult and Public Campus Ministry is collaborating with youth as well. I met with Pastor Shalina, and we are going to have a skit trip in January. So you will hear more from us. But again, in January, the third Sabbath, we're going to Edge Church to pray for the church and also have a wonderful time. And please mark your calendar. The third weekend of March will be PCM, Young Adult Retreat at North Star. And we're all going to freeze together. All right.
All right, so let's bow our heads. Father, thank you so much for this opportunity to be able to praise you in song. And I pray that you bless the performers who all got together to use this outlet to praise your name. Be with us throughout the week, and I pray that you equip us with your Holy Spirit so that we can continue to witness to those around us and also those in the world too. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Well, thank you again, everyone, for coming. I just wanted to come up to remind each one of you to please remember, just walk outside, right opposite the door. Everything is all set for you for food. We love that you're here, and we're hoping to see you in January. Our program's officially ended. God bless you and happy holidays. Yeah.